My name is Judy Brouse, and I'm the Executive Director of NAAEE, and I am really thrilled that all of you could join us today, because I think you're in for a special treat. We have a guest speaker, Sydney Chafee, who was the 2017 Teacher of the Year, and she'll be speaking about social justice in the schools. And I think you're really going to enjoy hearing from Sydney and listening to how she encourages all teachers to actually take risks and empower students and teachers to be change agents. So I'm really excited about this. I also want to thank all of our affiliate co-hosts who are part of our webinar series and who are advertising webinars throughout their states and regions and provinces. And it really is a wonderful partnership. And if you are not a member of your state or regional or provincial affiliate, I encourage you to join. Great organizations, and it's a fantastic network. And again, welcome to our series. For those of you who are new, every month we have a webinar on many different topics, and what we're trying to do is bring new ideas and thinking to the field. We showcase leaders in the field like Sydney, who are working in environmental education and other related disciplines, in this case, social studies and some of the work that Sydney is doing with her students. And we really want to improve practice and quality in our field. You can always let us know what you think, and we'll have more on this at the end by sending your ideas to me or Kristen Kunkel at NAAE.org. And next month we have a webinar, a wonderful panel on early childhood. I encourage you to take a look at that. We're posting that right now. And in January, we'll be hearing from Angela Park, who many of you know is an expert on helping organizations focus on diversity, equity, and inclusion. She has done so much to move the bar forward on creating a more equitable and inclusive movement. So you don't want to miss that either. For those of you who are new, and I know many of you know how to use Zoom, but just want to remind you that all of you are muted because we would have way too much background noise, but you can send us messages and communicate with the chat box. It's at the black bar at the bottom, and you can send a message to the panelists or to an individual or to everyone. So you can just do the drop-down message there and figure out who to send it to. And please ask questions, make comments, let us know who you are, where you're from. That is all really good. And you can not only type questions throughout, and we'll try and answer some of them periodically throughout the webinar, but we'll also try and answer some at the end of the webinar. And if we have extras, we'll answer them on EE Pro and work with Sydney on that. But you can also post other resources or ideas as you hear Sydney talking. If you have any technical problems, we're so lucky to have Drew and Tia on our team here who are helping manage the chat room and also just helping with any technical issues. So just go ahead and email them during the presentation if you're struggling at all with the technology or you have a question. Okay, and Drew and Tia, thank you so much. And now I am so excited to introduce Sydney Chafee, our speaker today. Sydney is a National Board Certified Teacher with a passion for helping diverse learners grow through authentic, relevant, interdisciplinary curricula. She believes that education is an essential tool to work towards social justice. She says it can transform students' self-perceptions and arm them in the fight to create a more just world. Throughout the school year, Sydney and her students seek to answer big questions like, what is justice? How have people resisted injustice throughout history? What can people do to have the power to change the world? And so as the Teacher of the Year, she is committed to taking risks for her students and will encourage all educators to take risks with their students, with each other, and with themselves. As a humanities teacher at Codman Academy Charter Public School in Boston, she takes risks every day to improve learning for all of her students. In the classroom, she strives to create lessons that demonstrate how education can be a transformative tool for social justice, and she encourages her students to see themselves as actually having the power to make change in the world based on lessons from the past. As she says, education must be authentic. There is no use in studying history if we believe it to be static and irrelevant to the future. She tries to infuse the hard work of learning with joy, not only in her classroom, but throughout the school. For example, she is the coordinator of a school-wide community circle every Thursday, where all students in the school come together to celebrate successes, share good news, and dig into serious conversations together. She has taught for the past 10 years, 9 of which have been in her current role. She earned a Bachelor of Arts from Sarah Lawrence College and a Master's of Education from Lesley University. In the spring and summer of 2013, Sydney worked as a consultant on EL's education curriculum design project, collaborating with educators from across the country to write 8th grade curricular modules. And since their publication, they've been downloaded more than 3 million times and implemented by over 1,000 schools nationwide. So let's give Sydney a warm virtual welcome, and she'll be sharing her screen. And Sydney, welcome to NAAE in our webinar series. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Hi, everyone. I've been keeping an eye on the chat box. It's cool that there are people here from all over the country. So thanks for joining. I'm sitting here in Boston. I taught kids this morning and my class is happening right now while I'm here with you. So hopefully everything's going smoothly down there. So I'm just going to share my screen and share some stuff with you about what I do, and then we'll open it up for questions at the end, and I'm hopeful that we can just have a good discussion. So let me get this going. I'm going to start by just telling you a little bit about the context in which I teach. So I'm confident in the technology that you can all see this. So again, my name is Sydney. I teach at a tiny little public charter school in Boston called Codman Academy. We are K through 12. We are public. We're a full inclusion school. And we serve about, I think, 250 or 300 kids, grades K through 12. So we're really tiny. Our school is part of a national network called EL Education. It was formerly called Expeditionary Learning. And originally, EL Education or Expeditionary Learning grew out of Outward Bound and was sort of founded in those principles of learning by doing and exploring, and sort of getting in touch with the natural world as a way to deepen our understanding and challenge ourselves. And so now this model of schools is, again, it's grown, it's nationwide, it's charter schools, it's traditional public schools. And the way that we teach kids is that we believe student mastery of skills and content is really important. Character education is also really important, and kids producing high quality work is really important. So we ground our teaching in real world experiences, in authenticity and relevance to kids' lives, and in projects. So that's EL education. Like I said, my school is an inclusion school and I teach 9th grade. So I've been the 9th grade humanities teacher here at Codman. This is my 12th year. So I'm teaching 14 and 15 year olds every day, including this morning. And I love them. That's my jam. And this picture is actually two of my darlings putting on a play at the end of the year. So I'll jump down to the bottom. My class is humanities, which is a mix of ELA or English, world history, and then actually theater. So we have this really cool partnership with a local theater company here in Boston called the Huntington Theater Company. And every year my kids put on a play at the end of the year. And that play is sort of grounded in the theme of the class for the year, which is justice and injustice. So we look at world history through the lens of justice and injustice, and we look specifically at 4 case studies of times in world history where people faced injustice caused by colonialism, and then how they sought justice or how they defined justice and worked towards it. And so our play at the end of the year, in this case, this picture is a play of 2 girls doing a scene from a South African play called Sizwe Bansi is Dead, which is set during apartheid era South Africa. And they're exploring big themes about like identity and racism and So that's me, that's my context. I like to think about my class as being situated at the intersection of literacy, theater, and social justice. So everything that I do is sort of combining those areas. The work in humanities, the way that we define it in our school and in EL education, is super interdisciplinary. And sort of just thinking about how can we teach history in a way that feels really relevant to kids' lives and relevant to what's happening in the world today. And that's where the social justice angle comes in. And because I've had this amazing opportunity to teach in a school and in a network of schools that's really great. In 2017, I was named first the Massachusetts State Teacher of the Year, and then from there, the National Teacher of the Year. And so I took the year last year to go on sabbatical and to travel all around the country and to some other countries talking about the work that teachers do and what is important in education and what's hard in education and what's beautiful in education. And that was a really incredible experience. And now I'm back in my classroom trying to sort of juggle both of those roles. So I'm back in my normal day-to-day work of just working with kids and helping them learn about history and English and social justice. And then also doing events like this where I'm sort of reaching out to broader audiences and still doing that sort of ambassadorship of teachers and teaching more generally. So that's what and where I teach, but I think it's often more important or more interesting when we talk to teachers to talk about why we teach. And so this idea that social justice belongs in our schools is something that's really core to who I am as a teacher and to the advocacy work that I've done as National Teacher of the Year. This is something that grounds my teaching and that helps me remember why teaching matters, especially on the days that are really hard. So the days when my 14 and 15 year old babies don't want to learn about history or don't want to read the book that we're reading or whatever it is, reminding myself that I'm doing the work for a bigger reason, which is that I believe, as Judy said in the intro, that education can help us build a more just world. And so I've sort of become known for this idea as a National Teacher of the Year and wanted to talk to you a little bit about where that came from. I wasn't a great teacher my first year. All of you who are teachers, I'm sure, are familiar with that phenomenon. Being a first-year teacher is really hard, and we're generally not very good. And so to be recognized in my 10th and 11th year of teaching as someone who is doing an okay job at this, it's interesting for me to think about, well, where did all of that come from? How did I get started in the work, and how did I get to a place where I feel like there are things that I'm doing that are worth sharing with other people? So I wanted to tell you the story behind this picture, because this picture for me is, this is the why. This is why I teach. This picture was taken, as you can see, in November of 2008. It was taken the morning after Obama was elected for the first time. And this is a group of my kids from my school standing outside on the street corner doing an impromptu celebration, rally, honk for Obama thing. And so I want to take you back to 20 minutes before this picture was taken. I was in my second year of teaching. I had no idea what I was doing, but I thought I knew what I was doing for sure. And I was starting class that morning, and I was really excited to talk to the kids about the election. And I was like, this is so historic. My kids are going to be so happy. I'm so happy. Like, let's talk about what this means for our country. So I had my lesson plan prepared. I had my do now prepared. Again, those of you who are teachers, you know the do now is like the thing that they're gonna do when they come into the class, and they're gonna do it silently, and everything's going to be so orderly and wonderful. And then after we got through all that work, we were gonna talk about the election. This was my big plan. And I was really patting myself on the back for being so responsive to students' needs that we would talk about the election. So class starts, and I have my little clipboard in front of me, and I'm taking attendance, and there's one kid in the room. And so I'm going through my attendance, and I'm sort of like marking everyone absent really diligently. And this kid is sitting there, and he's working on his do now, and he's sort of looking at me, and I'm looking at him, and we're just sort of pretending that this is normal. And then he raises his hand. He's the only one in the room. So he raises his hand, and I call on him, and he says, where is everybody? And I was like, I don't know, but they're late and they need to turn in their homework. And so I like go back to my clipboard. And a minute later, my principal runs in, and he looks at us like we've absolutely lost our minds. And he says, what are you guys doing? Go outside. And so me and this one kid, I like drop my little clipboard and we go outside. And this is the scene that we encounter. The entire school, all the kids and all the staff, are outside on the street corner holding this rally. And I remember realizing in that moment that my plan, as good as I thought it was, wasn't actually going to meet the kids' needs in that moment. And that the plan was you know, like there were important things in that lesson plan, but what we needed to do on that day was we needed to be a little bit flexible and make some time for what the kids were feeling and make some time for what they wanted to do in response to this historic election that had just happened. And so when I think about how I became the kind of teacher who talks a lot about social justice, I think about events like that. And I think about the fact that I'm lucky enough to have been raised as a teacher in an environment where my principal was the one who came into the room and said, hey, stop being silly, get outside, something's happening. And I like that story too, because sometimes people who criticize these ideas of mine about social justice having a place in what we do as teachers, they'll say, well, you're wrong, because your job as a teacher is to teach your subject, right? Your job as a teacher, you teach history and English, you need to teach history and you need to teach reading and writing, and that's it. And if you're doing anything other than that, what you're really doing is you're brainwashing kids, right? You're trying to indoctrinate them. I love this story because in this case, the kids were absolutely leading me, right? I wasn't trying to push on them my version of events or what I thought should happen. The kids were saying, this is what we need, this is what we want. And so for 20 minutes that morning, we held this rally being led by them. And then we went back to class and we learned the things that we needed to learn, and we made connections between that and what was happening in current events and all of that. But for me, this picture represents sort of the ideal in our work, which is that through education and in the work that we do in schools, kids become empowered to raise their voices and to talk about and to demonstrate for the things that they think are important. So I really believe that social justice does belong in schools, and I believe that if we're doing our work well, that the work of education should be liberatory. But I also believe that our aim is not to tell students to believe what we believe, but to empower them to articulate their own opinions and to make space in our classrooms and to make space in the way that we teach to allow students to sort of hone their ideas and their voices and learn how they could express those ideas and how they can get involved in the work of changing the world. So I always like to share a few other examples. So in 2014, the kids at my school staged a protest. They walked out of school. It was after Michael Brown's death in Ferguson, Missouri. There was a citywide student protest, which is what this picture and this news article is about. Our kids at our school decided to stage a walkout and join that protest. And so again, it was a place where as adults, we weren't super excited about them walking out. We didn't know if they were gonna be safe. We didn't know if they, some of us were like, well, do they even know why they're walking out, or do they just wanna get out of school? Like, it was very sort of typical adult responses to kids saying, hey, we're gonna break your rules. But in the end, what ended up happening was they marched downtown together, they took care of each other, they joined this protest, and they came back with a lot of ideas and wanting to talk about, okay, what is this movement that's happening and how do we get involved and how can we make sure that all the energy we felt today actually continues and keeps going and makes a difference. This is a picture of some kids demonstrating in this past year for March for Our Lives. I know a lot of us in education have been really affected by the youth movements that have been coming out, protesting gun violence and protesting lax gun laws. And certainly that's not a new movement, but we've seen it pick up a ton of steam since last February and just get a lot more mainstream attention, which has been really sort of heartening for me as a teacher, because I think the attention and the movement that these kids are getting and causing gives me a lot of hope for what our kids are capable of. And so that's something that I think we've seen a lot of over this past year. And it's something that speaks again to the power of kids, the power of youth, the power of their voices. The other thing that I really like about the story of the kids, specifically in Parkland in Florida, who got really famous and who sort of launched the March for Our Lives movement specifically, is that they really credited one of their teachers for helping them learn how to think and how to argue and for helping them understand the context of talking about gun control specifically. So if you saw that speech that Emma Gonzalez made like a day or two after the shooting, she's holding this big sheaf of papers and she says, oh, these are my AP notes. And so using what she had learned with her teacher about how to make arguments and how gun lobbyists argue and how people generally respond to school shootings and to mass shootings, she turned that into part of her activism. So for me as a teacher, it's obviously really tragic that any kid had to go through that, but to have her directly draw a line between the work that she was doing in a classroom in her AP class and the work that she was doing in the real world as an activist, that felt to me really important. And then of course you've got Mari Kopany, Little Miss Flint, who became an activist when she was what, like 8 years old, wrote a letter to President Obama, and has raised, you know, tens of thousands of dollars and is just doing so much work in Flint, Michigan, in terms of the fight for clean water and just raising awareness. So she obviously is another one who, for me, is super inspirational and an example of why we need to do work in schools with our young people that builds on the things that they are passionate about, the things that they're curious about, the things that they're angry about. Because when we do that, we can help them, again, change the world. So for me, I think that schools are crucial places for young people to become active citizens. All of that youth activism that I was just talking about can happen when we believe that education exists for a larger purpose, that it exists to go beyond the four walls of the classroom or the walls of the school, that education is about more than schooling. Education is about liberation. Education is about helping kids actually shape the world that they want to live in. But all of that actually doesn't require, in my opinion, a radical rethinking of the work that we're doing in schools. Because the skills that we want kids to build already are actually the skills that are going to help them become active citizens and activists. So we already want kids to learn how to solve problems. We want them to learn critical thinking. We want them to learn how to work together and how to be resilient. And we want them to learn the historical context of activist movements. That's the one that might be a little bit more radical. But those first four, like, I don't think that's really all that controversial that those are skills that we want students to learn in school today. Those skills lead kids to be able to work for justice. So I don't think that it's necessarily controversial to talk about teaching kids these kinds of skills. The controversy comes in when we say, well, we want kids to learn these kinds of skills so that they can become activists or so that they can identify problems in the world. And that's when people come out and accuse me of being a socialist or a brainwasher. But I don't actually think that what we're trying to aim for in helping our kids become active citizens is all that radical. When I say historical context, I mean, as a history teacher, it's near and dear to my heart that kids understand the spiral that is history and that if we can understand patterns that have happened in the past, we can sort of see what's happening today through that lens. We can try to interrupt patterns of injustice and inequity. And we can sort of put names to things that are happening today by saying, oh, this actually reminds me of this thing that happened in history and here's why I think that's important and what we can learn from it. So this also goes the other direction. So if we can teach students these skills and empower them to work for justice, they actually, working for justice and being activists will help them build a bunch of skills and do a bunch of things in their future as well. So working for justice and being activists helps them become more critical thinkers. It helps them develop their leadership skills, and it correlates to increased political participation, civic engagement, and commitment to their communities later in life. So empowering kids to actually do work that matters in the world and work for justice, it helps in the long term with our society becoming more just and more equitable, and a society where more of our citizens are able to participate and raise their voices in what's going on. Here's the thing though, we're not, if we believe this, right? If we believe education is a space to work towards justice, if we believe that we should teach these skills and that's gonna help our kids become activists, sometimes people will say, well, you know, you're pushing kids into doing something that you want them to do. Again, this is your agenda and you're trying to push this on kids. My argument against that comes from my work in the classroom, which is that we're not actually pushing kids into something that they aren't already talking about. So when people say, you know, controversial issues should stay out of the classroom, controversial issues are never gonna stay out of the classroom because our kids are bringing them in. right? Our kids are paying attention to what's happening, and they're bringing questions into the classroom with them, and they're bringing news articles that they saw, or something they saw on social media, or something they heard someone say at home, and they're saying, hey, what's this about, right? Kids are making the connections between what's happening right now, current events, and the history that they're learning. Even if I said nothing, when I start teaching my kids about the history of apartheid in South Africa, they make the connection between anti-apartheid resistance movements and the Black Lives Matter movement always, every year. I don't ever actually have to bring that up. They bring it up. We were learning today, this morning, we were learning about apartheid in South Africa, and we were just starting, we've just started this unit yesterday. And so we're starting to learn about, okay, well, what was apartheid? What's the definition? And what were ways that apartheid was unjust? How did that system unjustly segregate people? And a kid raised her hand and she said, I think that people today are still segregated. So can we talk about that? So kids are bringing these things into the classroom. And so it's up to us, really, if we want to do right by our kids, to have a plan for how we're going to address that and how we're going to make sure that when they bring controversy into the classroom, when they raise these questions in the classroom, we know how we're going to handle it. I think sometimes people will say, well, you know, we need to just keep controversy out of the classroom because it's too political, it's too hard. That's not actually realistic. Our kids will bring these things up. So there was a study done in 2015 of incoming college freshmen. They surveyed incoming college freshmen and they said, how likely is it that you're going to participate in protests while you're at college? And 8.5% of these incoming freshmen said, yeah, there's a really good chance that I'm going to protest something, which I think is funny. And that number, when I first looked at it, I thought, okay, well, that actually doesn't really line up with what I'm thinking. I'm thinking kids are really interested in activism, but this doesn't line up. But actually, that's the largest number of kids to say that since the late 1960s. And similarly, 75% roughly of kids said helping others who are having difficulty is a really important goal for them. I think we can draw a line between that and activism as well. I think that also is sometimes a less controversial or political way to think about what social justice means, is that we're trying to teach kids, well, how do we help other people who are having difficulty? How do we set up systems, or how do we address systems that are inequitable, so that are causing people to have difficulty? And again, that number, that 75% number, that's also the highest number of kids to report that since the late 1960s. So all of that is great, right? That's my belief. That's how I think about the work that we do and why it matters and why it's important. But the big question then is, okay, but how do we do it, right? So I've been lucky enough, like I said, to work in a school where I've always been really supported in talking about social justice. The title of my class, I told you, was Justice and Injustice. I didn't make that up. When I got hired here as a baby first-year teacher, they said, your class is going to be called Justice and Injustice. So that's the context that I walked into. So I've been incredibly lucky and incredibly privileged to be able to do this work that I'm really passionate about and to be able to, like I said, be raised up in this environment as a teacher. But not everyone necessarily has that. And in speaking to Judy, I know that one of the things that a lot of you all are facing is that there are real controversies around things like climate change. And there are families who will send kids in who say, I don't believe in that. Right? I don't believe in that. And so then the student says, my family doesn't believe in that. Why should I learn about it? That's really real. So I wanted to sort of share some strategies and ideas and resources that I have found useful or that my colleagues have found useful around how can we start to teach towards social justice? How can we start to tackle controversy in our classrooms in a way that feels good? So I don't know what order these are going to pop up in because I did this really quickly, but perfect. Okay. So structured academic controversy is something that I learned from some other teachers at a conference a few years ago, but it's basically, and I'm happy to, I'll give you my email at the end. And if anyone wants to email me, I can dig this up and send you the actual protocol, but it's basically a protocol where students read an article in pairs. They take some notes on an assigned opinion about that article. They pair up with another group that has the opposite opinion. They have sort of a little mini debate where they share different evidence back and forth. Then they go back with their original partner, and now they have to find evidence to argue against themselves. So they swap sides of the debate. They meet up again, they share that evidence, and then at the end, after they've read, gathered evidence, and argued both sides, then they sort of articulate as the final step, okay, here's what I think. I like that protocol because it forces kids to look at different sides of an argument. And as the teacher, all you're doing is presenting information. So you're saying, here's this article that presents facts about this issue. Now you figure out what you think. You figure out what people will argue on both sides. And I remember when I went to the conference and learned about this protocol, they had us read two articles about fracking. And so we were like taking notes, we were figuring out what does fracking mean, what is it? And then we were trying to pull evidence on both sides. And it taught me a lot as an adult about, oh, let me make sure I actually understand the other side of this thing. Let me make sure I understand what the evidence is. So I think that that's a helpful exercise. I think it's also really helpful. You know, our political climate right now is really polarized. And I think a lot of times as adults, we sort of have our opinion, we have our belief, and we stick to it. And we don't do a good enough job of modeling for kids what it means and what it looks like to consider other sides of an issue and to make sure that what we think is informed, right? And that we have evidence for what we think. PBL, project-based learning, I think that when we're gonna work towards social justice in schools, we've gotta ground it, like I've said a couple times, in relevance and in authenticity. So looking at projects that our kids can engage in over a longer period of time that address real needs in the community. The community in this case could be the school, or it could be the neighborhood, or it could be the state, or it could be the country, but getting kids interested in what's a problem, what's a project, what's something that we could actually contribute, and then having them work on that in a longer term way and actually have them see at the end that the work that they did is bigger again than just the classroom. So PBL. Interdisciplinary studies, I think so much of this work around social justice, and especially I think when we're thinking about environmental ed, has to be interdisciplinary. So really thinking about, okay, when I was talking to Judy last week, she said, you know, a lot of folks have trouble because they say, well, here's this controversial issue. I'm just gonna teach the science of it because that's less controversial. If I just teach the science and I sort of don't touch the social justice or the equity piece of it, that's a little bit safer. But I think figuring out how do you teach the science of a controversial issue and then also introduce a text that you can read that would be more, you know, social studies or English. How do you work with other teachers to sort of help kids understand this, not just through the lens of science, which is obviously really important, but also through the lens of, like, I don't know, the effect on humans or whatever it is. So interdisciplinary studies. I also think when we're talking about authenticity, the way we learn is not siloed. So when we are, as adults, are curious about something, we generally look at it in an interdisciplinary way just naturally. We say, oh, that's interesting. I wonder what percentage of people are affected by this. Oh, I wonder what that word means. Oh, here's a story about somebody who was affected by it. I'm gonna read that. We bounce all around. So teaching kids that that's how things work in the real world, that it's interdisciplinary, I think is really important. Multiple perspectives. This is obviously a super huge tool. So I always recommend to people who say, I'm afraid to bring up something about social justice in my classroom because I don't want people to think I'm trying to just make the kids believe what I believe. I think talking to kids about multiple perspectives and just presenting them with multiple perspectives on issues is so powerful. We don't have to say a word. We say to them, here's the issue. Here's the topic we're going to talk about. Here's this article. Like, I remember last trimester, we were talking about Columbus Day. Here's an article of someone who believes Columbus Day should be abolished. Here's an article of someone who believes that Columbus Day should not be abolished. You're gonna read both of them and we're gonna talk about it. I think that that sometimes can feel safer to teachers in terms of controversial issues because it's not you saying your opinion, it's you presenting the kids with appropriate and complex texts and asking them to grapple with ideas. I think I already talked about this, but historical context and connections, making sure that we understand when we're talking about social justice, we're not talking about something isolated to today. It's all connected to the history that we want our kids to learn and looking for connections. So asking kids, here's this thing that we just learned about. What connections can you make to today? So again, that's a place where, like I said, at my school, I wouldn't shy away from making connections to Black Lives Matter. But if I were at a school where I would be a little bit afraid to make connections to something, to like a political movement or activist movement, I could just say to kids, What connections can you make right now between what we're learning about and something that you see in the news? And sort of draw that out and see what kids come up with themselves. Okay, so Teaching Tolerance is an amazing website with lots of free resources for teachers. They actually have social justice standards that I think are really great. And those standards can be used in like any grade level. So checking out those standards and just figuring out, all right, what's the one standard that I want to start with? So I think sometimes this social justice work can feel really overwhelming, especially when people like me say things like, we're gonna just teach kids how to change the world. But I think having some standards to ground ourselves in and say, oh, this one feels really reasonable. I'm just gonna start with this one and we're gonna build from there. So I would definitely check those out. Teaching kids media literacy, I think is incredibly important right now. And so just giving them some, equipping them with some skills to look at media sources and media messages and discern for themselves whether they can trust that message, I think is something that we definitely need to have an eye on right now. And we can teach them that by looking first at like historical sources and then move to applying that to modern day media sources. And I think, again, that's a thing where we can ground that in history. We can ground that in history content and English content. And then we can say, now we're making a modern day connection because our kids are going to find that relevant. Debates, structured academic controversy is obviously a type of debate, but I think in general, allowing kids to have debates in a way that is safe and that is structured, that there are routines and protocols can be really helpful in helping them dig in to these issues. And I think, again, debates where we assign them to a certain side can be really helpful in, you know, making sure that they're considering multiple perspectives. Scholastic, New York Times, and Newzella all have really great resources for teachers in terms of informational texts. So again, if we're looking for texts that present multiple perspectives on an issue, for example, using those resources as teachers, I think can be super helpful. And Newzella, if you haven't, some people say News ELA, it's controversy, I don't know. I say Newzella. If you haven't ever used it or looked at it, it will give you readings on a topic that are at different reading levels for different kids. You can ask questions and have the, it'll like track data for you about your kids' reading. It's really good. So that's one. Over here, hold on, I gotta move my own face out of the way. Oh, okay, so the Choices curriculum, this comes out of Brown University and I love it. I don't know if there are any that are specifically about environmental ed. It would be worth looking into, but basically the way this works is they take a moment in history where people had a choice to make. They go through the background of what happened, you know, make sure kids know all of the important figures and the context and whatever. And then there's a role play in class where kids take on the persona of people in history and have to sort of debate what they're gonna do at that moment in history. So for example, there's one about apartheid where the kids learn about what happened up until 1961. And then the debate is about, should we, as people living in South Africa in 1961 who oppose apartheid, should we continue to use nonviolent resistance methods or should we begin using violent resistance? And if we wanna begin using violent resistance, should it be violent in this way or in this way? So those are really great curricula. They're not free, but they're worth the money. And they have lots of online resources that go with them, videos from experts and all sorts of other things. So highly recommend Choices. And they also, Choices is great because they're really responsive to what's happening in the news. So when something big happens in the news, they'll come out with like a lesson or a resource for teachers right away and post that. So you can also sign up. Choices has a newsletter for teachers. You can sign up and they'll email you if they have a new resource that comes out. Okay, almost done. Okay, there's the last two. So experts, I think bringing in experts, again, really helps kids see how what they're learning matters in the world outside. So bringing in someone to talk about the issue that you're working on or bringing in someone who's lived through the time period you're studying or the issue that you're studying. So I've had people come in before who lived in South Africa during apartheid and kids remember the evidence they gather from that person's story more than anything else we read or do in the whole trimester. So I think it's incredibly powerful to just bring people in and have them talk to kids about what they've experienced. And then finally, NSTOY is the National Network of State Teachers of the Year. They compiled a social justice reading list, which goes from kindergarten to 12th grade and also has a section for teachers. So I think, again, if this is something that you're starting to think about how do I teach towards social justice or how do I work this stuff into my curriculum, picking a really great book can be obviously an awesome way to get started with this work. And yeah, these are books that are like chosen and vetted by award-winning teachers from across the country. So those are some resources that I've used or that people I know have used that I think can be helpful. I think a couple of other things I wanted to just bring up are having a network of other teachers who are doing this work is really important. And if you feel like you don't have that at your school or in your district, if you feel like you're trying to do this work alone, I strongly recommend Twitter as a virtual PLN, professional learning network for teachers. EduTwitter is like amazing. So the number of teachers who are on Twitter sharing incredible ideas and doing chats with each other is really, really amazing. And so I think just like getting started on Twitter, even if the only thing you do at first is you just follow some people that inspire you and just see, okay, who are they following? Who are they retweeting? And just start sort of building up the number of people that you're looking at, I think can be really, really important and super helpful. I joined Twitter when they named me Teacher of the Year and I was like, I'm too old for this. I don't know how to do this. This is really weird. And now, you know, a year or so later, I feel like it's just such an important place for me to go to get information from other teachers on what they're doing or how they're handling issues or, you know, like what books they're reading. The other thing I wanted to say is I know that the audience today is pretty diverse. So if there's anyone on the line who's an administrator in a school, I've been able to do the work that I do because of support from my administrators. I always knew that my principal had my back in the work that I was doing and that he believed that the work that I was doing in my classroom around social justice was important and mattered and was good for our kids and good for our community. So if you're an administrator, I would just encourage you to really support your teachers. And one way that I would think about doing that is to ask them if you haven't, what topic or text do you really want to teach but you're nervous to teach? And what is holding you back from doing it? So survey your teachers and find out what's the thing that is holding them back. Is it that they are worried that the kids will argue with each other and it won't be productive? Is it that they're worried that they'll get pushback from parents? Is it that they're worried that they'll get pushback from you? And just sort of start to dig in what is going on in your teachers' minds and what do they need from you? Okay, so I'm gonna just share this quote with you because I love it. Activism itself can generate hope. I think this is a time where we and our kids need to have a ton of hope in the future. And I have a ton of hope in our kids as the ones who are sort of creating our future. So I think helping kids understand that they can change the world, they can make a difference in the world, and they can be activists is a way to help engender a lot of hope in that in the younger generation. So I'm going to give you my contact information here. If you want to, you know, reach out to me for any of the resources that I talked about or to follow up on anything, this is all my information here. And I'm going to put myself on mute and stop talking and hopefully answer some questions.
Thank you, Sydney. That is so good. I'm going to, we have three questions, actually four questions for you so far, and some more are probably coming in on the chat room. But thank you. That was such a great overview. One of the questions that Tia had is, what strategies do you find successful for encouraging and empowering student voice in your lessons? What do you actually do to get the student's voice out there?
Yeah, this is a great question. Because again, if I think back to myself as a new teacher, there wasn't a ton of student voice, right? I was like, I am the holder of information and I will open up their brains and pour my information in and it'll just be great. And as I've gotten better at being a teacher, I understand that I should be doing much less talking. So in terms of thinking about strategies, let's see, doing class discussions, I do a ton of group work. The kids get kind of annoyed. I do a lot of partner work and group work where I'm asking kids, okay, here's a question I want you to talk about, talk to your table about it, and then we're gonna talk as a whole class. And that's a way for me to make sure that I'm not just telling them what to think, but I'm giving them a chance to think about it first and then inviting them to sort of talk about it as a whole class. and I think I said A and there was supposed to be a B. It's been a long day. I've been teaching. I also do literature circles, which I think are an awesome structure to have kids talk about literature and talk about books like adults do. So literature circles, there are great books by Harvey Daniels that sort of go over what literature circles look like when they're running really well. One thing that I do is, like today we did a miniature lit circle where we used a lot of the structures and routines from lit circles to talk about an article that we read last night. So just doing like lots of protocols and routines where kids can talk to one another about whatever we're learning rather than me telling them what they should think. Yeah, those are the two that come to mind right away. I'm also working right now on trying to get, there's this website called Citizen Discourse where kids can connect with each other and learn how to debate and how to have sort of civil discourse with each other online, which again, I think, I talked about media literacy already, but I think about knowing how to communicate with people online in a way that's like productive is a really important skill right now. So I'm working on getting that going with my kids, and the way we'll use that is like, we'll have little debates and discussions on those sort of chat boards. And we can also connect with kids in other schools using that. So I'm excited about the possibility of that as well.
Great, Sydney, thanks. Another question came from Anne, and she said some teachers and principals are really focused, and we know this is true, on classroom teaching that focuses on reading and math over pretty much everything else, including experiential learning. And of course, a lot of people in environmental education are trying to get the students outside and doing experiential learning. What are some ways that you would recommend persuading teachers and principals that there's value in getting outside, not just for science, but for every single subject, including reading and math?
This is such a good question. And it's, you know, it's like the bane of so many teachers' existence that education has become drilled down to reading and math, reading and math, reading and math, and that there's this false dichotomy set up, right? That it's either reading and math or experiential education, right? It's either reading and math or project-based learning. But actually, when we do experiential ed right, when we do PBL right, we're doing reading and math. But we're doing it in a way that's going to stick with kids because it's relevant, it's authentic, it's engaging. So I think that's like a mindset shift that we have to help people make. And I think that for a lot of folks, they're not going to make that shift unless they see it. Like they've got to see it work. So I think a few things. One, EL education does have curricular modules for both, for English, not for math, just for English. Engage New York has ones for math, I think, that are, it's the EL education model, right? So it's experiential, it's complex, it's rooted in like real world questions and issues, but it's also completely aligned to the Common Core standards. So that can be sort of a way to start with this kind of thinking and this kind of work is to say, all right, we're gonna try out one of these curricular modules. They're 8 weeks long. They have them from, I think it's third through eighth grade. And we know that they're aligned to the standards. And we know that they're created by an organization that, I think that these curricular modules, I think they received like the highest rating possible that curricular modules or curricula or whatever can get. So it can be a way to say, look, we know this is a good resource. This is a vetted resource. This is a resource that's aligned to standards. And it's a resource that's gonna push us a little bit towards this more experiential way of learning. So I think that can be one way to do it is like often, unfortunately, just teachers and just educators saying, hey, we know that teaching in this way will work. Unfortunately, that's not often enough. And so we have to bring in like, well, here's this published curriculum. Can we try this instead? I think the other thing is just, we've gotta be really, really clear when we do experiential education or when we say, I'm gonna take the kids outside, that we're able to say, and here are the standards that we're gonna hit by doing that. I think that makes us better teachers when we're always planning backwards and we're always grounding what we do with kids in standards and in thinking about what we want them to learn. But it's especially helpful too when we can say to someone who is critical of teaching in that way, oh, no, look, I'm going to do this activity. We're going to take them outside. We're going to hit these standards and they're going to be really engaged. come observe me so you can see it happen. But I know that, you know, all of that is easier said than done, but I think those are a couple places.
Yeah. Great, Sydney. We have a lot of questions here. And so we have about, I think, 6 more minutes to be able to answer them. Janelle had a question about, it's kind of similar in the sense that in many schools, teachers and parents are worried about test scores and taking away from test prep time. How do you deal with that? It sounds like your school is pretty flexible, but any advice?
Yeah, our kids take the state test. And so we, when we're teaching them, like when I'm teaching my kids how to write an essay, I'm preparing them for the test, but the essay they're writing happens to be about which way of resisting injustice is the most effective. So again, I think that we need to show people, we are experts, right? Educators, teachers, we are experts in education. We need to show people that that's a false dichotomy. And we need to show people we can prepare kids for the test by doing work that is both rigorous and meaningful.
Sorry, I'm on mute, Sydney. I was just trying to prevent feedback. Another question we have from Mackenzie is that she works at a nature center, limited amount of time with the students, you know, an hour and a half to 2 hours. So what can we do to support teachers trying to do social justice work, number one, and what suggestions do you have as far as incorporating social justice concepts into programs that have the shorter time period and touch points with students? Because it's different in a nature center, of course, and a lot of the nature centers are working with students who work with teachers. So any advice on that, how to support teachers, and also what would you suggest to those of us working in environmental ed and in non-formal, the non-formal part of the world?
Yeah, this is a good question. I think, my best advice is that you've got to develop relationships with teachers and have a partnership. So what are the teachers working on and how can the work that you do supplement and enhance that, and vice versa. So I think sometimes we see our worlds as siloed, or sometimes teachers will make the mistake of thinking like, well, this is just this is a field trip, right? This is an isolated thing. But I think when we actually work to build partnerships with one another and talk about, okay, what are the longer term learning targets that we're trying to hit, or what are the big themes that we're trying to reinforce? We can make sure that we're underscoring that on both sides. So that's always my advice to folks who are working in education who say, well, how do I best support teachers? You've got to talk to teachers and have partnership with teachers and really, you know, like see your work as in partnership with one another. And that goes both ways. In terms of how do you do this work in a less formal educational environment, I think for me, the social justice and equity aspect in terms of environmental ed, it comes down to stories, people's stories. I mean, we're wired as humans to pay attention to stories, right? So thinking about when we're talking to kids about environmental ed, what's a story of someone that we can bring in to help them make that connection between what they're learning about and how it impacts humans? And I would imagine that's something you're doing already. I'm a little bit out of my comfort zone trying to give you advice on environmental ed, but I guess that's the one thing that I would think about. And the other thing I would say is a lot of this stuff, it feels really overwhelming, like I mentioned before, but if we can just think about what's the one small step that I'm gonna take, what's the one small step that I'm gonna try to weave social justice work or attention to equity into what I'm doing, just start there. That's all we can do, right? If we try and do everything all at once, just like in teaching in schools, it's gonna be so overwhelming. So again, I guess I would go back to those teaching tolerance social justice standards and say, maybe take a look at those. If you're working in a place like a nature center, and say, is there one of these that I can kind of pull out and weave through what I'm doing with kids?
Thanks, Sydney. I think we'll take one more. And this is from Kosi, who is a fellow. He's a Jeep fellow here at NAAE from Botswana. And he said in some places around the world, children at home are mainly taught and cultured to be passive and just follow how parents, you know, advise them to act in school. So they're very passive in the when they get to the classroom, and they don't ask questions and they're just very quiet. So how do you bring students out so that you're not contradicting family values and culture? Any ideas on that one? Great question, Cozy.
Yeah, it's a great question. I spent some time in other countries doing Teacher of the Year work, and this was definitely something that came up. One thing I would say is I think a lot of educators around the world are really mindful of this tension and are trying to do more student-centered work in a way that is culturally responsive. I think, again, coming back to the idea of partnering, we've got to feel, as educators, we have to see ourselves in partnership with students' families. So we can't see ourselves, we can't say to ourselves, well, the families are doing it wrong because they want kids to be passive, which I don't think that's what the question asker is saying, but I think sometimes that's a trap that teachers fall into, especially white teachers. So we have to ask ourselves, all right, how do I help students understand that in this classroom, there's going to be some ways that I'm going to ask you to push yourself out of your comfort zone? And maybe that's going to start with, we're going to do a pair share, you and another student talking about this thing that we're learning. And that's going to feel different and that's going to feel weird, but I'm gonna ask you that we try that. So I think it's about, like, we have to be mindful of where our kids are coming from, what their values are, what their families are telling them, and then also be able to explicitly teach them how to code switch into the educational environment and say, in this classroom, I want you to be able to ask questions. And so here's how I'm gonna set that up for you to learn how to do that.
Thank you so much, Sydney. There's a lot of other chatter in the chat room and a lot of ideas and a lot of sharing going on. I'll just ask you one other quick thing. Do you use the Sustainable Development Goals at all in your teaching? And I know a number of people that are on this webinar are using the Sustainable Development Goals as a framework, but do you use those with your humanities work?
I don't. I just heard about them last year because I think someone came to present to all the teachers of the year and showed it to us. I haven't started using it yet, but I think there might be a teacher at my school who is.
Well, what we will do, since we have a lot of other ideas in the chat room, is we'll continue the conversation. This session is being recorded for all of you who want to get some of the resources that Sydney talked to you about. And just want to really thank all of you for joining. And Sydney, thank you so much for the work you're doing. It really truly is inspirational. Everything you touched on connects to the work we do in environmental education. That's why the interdisciplinary part is so important on civic engagement, social justice, experiential learning. All of that is just good education and what we need to do to create active and engaged citizens as we think ahead. So thank you so much. I'm just going to ask you if you have any final thoughts and we'll wrap it up.
Yeah, I mean, I guess my final thought is just the work is hard, but it's worth it. I like to end with a little inspiration. So this work can feel really overwhelming. There are so many ways in which in education, we can constantly feel like we're not doing enough or like the problems are too big and how will we ever tackle it? But the work is worth it. And every little thing that we do and every little moment that we help a kid see that they actually do have the power to change the world, whether that's in a really big way or a really small way, that's worth it. And so I would just, you know, thank you all for the work that you're doing. And remember that even if it sometimes feels like you're in the work alone, you're not in the work alone.
Thank you, Sydney. And thank you for all that you've done and are doing. It's so easy to see why you were the Teacher of the Year in 2017. So thank you. Keep it up. We look forward to a continued relationship with you. And just want to thank you again for making the time and for what you're doing really in your school, but around the world to help us all think about how we incorporate social justice issues and teaching into whatever we're doing. So thank you. And again, you can find and share all the recorded webinars on EE Pro, and you'll get an email, everybody that's on this webinar, with the link so that you can re-listen or look at the resources that Sydney has brought up. We'd also love your ideas about new webinars in the future. What ideas do you have? What would you like to see? Do you want to suggest any? Please, please, please give us your feedback. That's how we'll keep this webinar series alive and wonderful. And again, we have two scheduled webinars coming up. We'll have the rest of the schedule in early next year for the year. Early Childhood in December on the 12th and Angela Park on January 29th. So more on all of that. Thank you all for joining us. Sydney, thank you so much. And thanks to everybody. Have a great rest of the day. Thanks again. And thanks, Tia and Drew, for all your help. Take care.